Cantabria, a region full of surprises. The Camino is such an integral part of this place that many religious stops are nothing short of historical. As we travel around Cantabria, we will have a chance to tour landmarks by the Spanish Alps and visit the local vineyards of the region. We will also be learning how to make the Sunday lunch favorite of many Filipino grandmothers, the classic cocido. Join us as we discover more of hidden Spain on this episode.
The world has finally opened up again, and as editor-in-chief of Metro Society, I take every opportunity to discover new places, meet new people, and explore different cultures. Join me in my journey to luxurious and meaningful experiences. This is Raul Manzano, EIC on the move.
On the Camino, some stops are certainly more famous than others. A single lifetime may never be enough to explore all of them. Today, our journey starts in Leibana, a small district in the Cantabrian Mountains. One of the more special destinations for the Camino passes through here, the Monasterio de Santo Toribio. Originally built by the Cistercian order during the 12th century, this sanctuary holds an important relic, the Lignum Crucis.
Estamos ante la reliquia más grande que se conserva de la cruz de Cristo, más grande que hay en el mundo. Una reliquia que llega a España en el siglo V, traída por Toribio de Astorga, una persona de este Villa de León, que va a Tierra Santa y allí es nombrado custodio, guardián de las reliquias que se conservan del tiempo de Cristo, entre ellas un trozo de la reliquia de la cruz encontrado por Santa Elena, la madre del emperador Constantino. Lo importante, yo siempre termino las visitas diciendo que son los ojos que miran, ¿verdad? Si viene una persona que no cree, solo va a ver una madera. El creyente, los creyentes vemos más, vemos quién estuvo clavado en la cruz.
So next you will open that door of pardon.
La puerta del perdón se abre solamente cuando es año jubilar. El año que viene es año jubilar y se abrirá el 16 de abril. Y durante todo un año estará abierta para los peregrinos que vengan y quieran tener la indulgencia y pasen por la puerta para que entren por esa puerta del perdón y salgan por la puerta normal. Esperamos ver el año que viene, que es año jubilar. Aquí, pues, son siempre bienvenidos. Como comunidad franciscana, paz y bien en vuestro itinerario que os queda todavía.
Muchas gracias, Padre.
Well into my travels, I knew that the rest of the trip would entail some spectacular meals and meeting some of the best chefs in the country. So what better way than to have a companion who knows her food, enjoys traveling as much as I do, and who is a top chef herself.
Raul!
How are you? It's good to see you.
I'm so happy to be here.
Welcome to Potes.
Wow, what a charming place Potes is.
This is supposed to be one of the most beautiful towns in Spain. So let's go explore.
Let's go take a look.
Let's go.
Many Filipinos remember cocido as a Sunday lunch dish, and this dish really brings back memories. Cocido was comfort food before the term comfort food even existed, and I'm really looking forward to seeing how the proper version is made. Juan Carlos, Thank you so much for having us here. Can you explain how you do the cocido?
Es una base de legumbre, garbanzo. Tiene que ser un garbanzo específico, el pequeñito. No el garbanzo grande. Y lleva pues un fondo de mucha carne, tocino, chorizo, eso. Partes del cerdo que se adobaban, las manos. Las orejas, con la miga del pan, sí, huevos, choricito picado dentro, perejil, lo hacemos una masa y lo freímos en aceite. Y se hacen unos pequeños bollos.
Balls made with the inside of the bread.
Y se acompaña con una verdura, puede ser repollo. O berza. De la cocción se saca un caldo que es bastante denso, muy contundente, con mucho sabor de las carnes. Se hace una sopa y luego se ponen los garbanzos con las carnes y el relleno.
In Manila, we make cocido also. Everything is boiled. It has chicken, pork, beef. Tongue, and also garbanzos, but we put string beans, potato,
cabbage,
and repollo also. And we usually eat it for Sunday lunch with the family. And then the soup is served separately.
Aquí también, de forma, en todas las casas, generalmente el fin de semana, el domingo, cuando se junta todo el mundo, era cuando se elaboraba el cocido.
We're excited to eat.
Yes.
Juan Carlos es cocido. Gracias.
Muy bien. Nada, gracias. A vosotros.
Gracias.
Flavor is smoky because of all those pork bones, the ears, and that were coated in pimento.
Yes. It's very tasty. Yeah. Excellent.
So wasn't that a terrific meal?
Super duper cocido, the authentic cocido.
So how does it compare to our cocido?
What I love about it is the smokiness of the spiced meats, the cured pork with the pimenton around it. You can taste all those like smoky flavors in the broth. So maybe that's where it's a bit different from ours.
And they also put the pasta in the broth, right?
Yeah, the fideos.
The fideos, yes.
Very interesting.
Very interesting. And you notice that they used all small garbanzos.
The garbanzos are tiny. So it's not so heavy as well. They used the miga, which is the white part of the bread. And they made it into kind of like a mash, together with eggs and persil and parsley and flavored with the broth apparently. So it came out like a tortilla, but then it was really just like a bread dumpling.
Okay, it was perfect. So now we had to Picos de Europa. We need to exercise, okay?
We need to climb a mountain.
Exactly. And we can play with snow.
Yeah, because there's snow cap. We can see it from here, actually. So I'm excited.
So am I. So let's go.
Let's go.
Margarita and I stopped by one of the main attractions here in the Cantabrian Mountains, the Picos de Europa. This mountain range spans almost 20 kilometers with an altitude of almost 3,000 meters. One cable car can bring you straight into the Alps in less than 10 minutes. We were lucky enough to catch the end of the snowy season. What a feeling to be on top of the world. Our next agenda, we wanted to learn more about Orujo, a local liqueur that is quite similar to the Italian grappa or the German schnapps. Orujo has been distilled in this region since the Middle Ages. Before modern Orujo distilleries were built, the local specialty was made at home and each family jealously guarded their heirloom recipes. Speaking of family-owned, the Orolisa Distillery has been producing Orujo since 1986 and is well-known in the region.
Aguardiente de Orujo.
Aguardiente de Orujo.
Yes, because we make the spirit from the grape, from the Orujo of the grape.
All right.
I am the second generation of the distillery because my mother was who start with the distillery. Yep. I have learned from my mother and my mother from my grandmother. Yes.
How do you start making the liquor?
The first is the grape. Yeah. Yes, we collect the grapes in the vineyard and then we make the wine. We make the wine only with natural and traditional method.
Okay.
Yes, no sulfite added and no enzymes added, nothing in the process.
Okay.
When we have finished the wine, mm-hmm. then we have the skins
of the grapes.
We use it to make the spirit, to make the orujo. These skins are called alquitaras.
Yes. Okay.
This is the word came from the Arab.
Okay.
It's Arabian word. And we make the orujo now that the same way that in this
olden times, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So you put everything in there?
Yeah, inside.
Okay.
We put inside the alquitara and then we close it.
Yeah, you close it. Yeah.
Yes. And we put fire because we have to have a vapor.
Vapor, okay.
Yes. Because the alcohol is have to evaporate.
Evaporate.
The heat inside the alquitara is around the 17 to 19 degrees.
Okay.
So this is the ideal for the alcohol evaporate, but not the water.
Not the water.
Also the alcohol. Okay. When we have the vapor from the alcohol, this in this part of the alquitara, we have cold water.
Cold,
because of the water, this is cold.
Okay.
When the vapor is in contact with the cold, with the cool metal, then the vapor
condenses into the liquid.
Yes. And this liquid is the spirit, and this is the orujo.
That's orujo, okay.
Yes.
Strong.
Not so strong.
Okay.
Don't worry.
Okay. I like strong.
No, we can try it.
Yeah. Okay.
Herbs.
Herbs.
Yes. No? This is a kind of herb that we have in the mountain.
Okay.
Over the 18 meters, we can find this kind of herb.
Okay.
And with the flower of this herb, we make this liquor.
Ah, okay.
But it's very common in the highest part of the mountain. Okay. Yes.
Interesting.
Cheers. And with sugar, yes.
Very smooth.
Yes, this is smooth because the taste of the herb is sutil, which is the
subtle.
Yes, not so strong like other liquors.
Yeah.
Yes, it's only for a higher level.
Yeah. So how long does it take to make
this one?
Yes. First we make the orujo and then we put in the herbs with the orujo and we have minimum 40 days with the orujo.
Okay.
Then we extract the herbs and mix with the sugar and with a little amount of water to reduce the
alcohol. So it's about 40 days.
I think 2 months.
2 months.
All the
everything
process.
Altogether.
Everything altogether. Yeah.
So this is now the coffee cream, no?
Yes. Yeah. With a little bit of orujo also.
Of orujo, huh? Oh, it's very good. Yeah, it's like candy. Yeah, it's true. Good,
coffee,
right?
Mm.
Candy with a twist.
Nice.
Yeah.
This is 17% alcohol.
17?
Yes.
That's not strong.
No.
Yeah, just right.
For this area, this is like a candy.
No, but it's very, very good.
Yeah, it's very good. Very good.
What kind of coffee do you
use for this. Natural coffee.
Natural, okay.
Very nice.
Very good. So Isabel, we saved the strongest for last. So Margarita and I would like to thank you for taking us around here.
You are always welcome.
Thank you so much.
I'm pleased to show and to learn.
Yeah.
To learn.
To teach.
Yeah. Also learn.
Yeah, to learn.
Always learning.
Always learning, yeah.
To teach the people how we make the things as good as with all the care.
Yes,
we
that
can.
You put, yes. So cheers.
Cheers. Salute.
And remember, now you have more connections in the
Philippines.
Time to come and visit us again.
Visit again.
Of course.
Yeah. Thank you.
No, you're welcome.
The surrounding district of Comillas has a number of wonderful surprises. We stopped by one of its oldest universities, the Comillas Pontifical University, which was established in 1890. Sonia, this is a beautiful door. Can you tell us a little bit about the
door? Yes, the name of this door is the Seven Virtues door.
Yes, okay.
And in contraposition, we have the Seven Sins. Seven sins are represented with the animals, but if you pay attention, you will only see six of them.
Yes.
I was going to ask you.
Do you know where the seventh is?
Up.
Up there?
Up. The virtue of Our Lady, humility, and against humility, where is the sin?
The sin.
Pride. What's the pride? Pride is the door because it is around 400 kilos each side of the door, almost a ton.
Yeah.
So that means a lot of money. This is made in bronze.
Yeah.
A lot of power. Yeah. Let's say the every richness is outside.
Yes.
While inside, well, the door is this
thick.
Yeah, thick.
Inside is just wood.
And then JSH is
Jesuit. The Jesuits. The whole building was given to the Pope, Leon the 13th.
Yeah.
And Leon the 13th decided to give it to the Jesuits. The Jesuits created a seminary. Comillas has always been a place with lots of priests.
Okay.
It was the only way, you have to consider that this was quite an isolated village, and it was the only way for many boys to escape from the village.
Yes.
That's why Comillas is also known as the Archbishop's village. There were around seven archbishops in different Spanish old colonies that had studied here in this first seminary, later university. If you didn't want to become priest, you could be specialized in theology and philosophy. And nowadays, the Comillas University lives in Madrid.
Yes.
That's the headquarters of Comillas University. And this belongs to the Cantabrian government, which offers to people all around the world to learn Spanish properly.
Very interesting.
That's why it has EHS.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
That is so incredible.
Welcome to Green Spain and Comillas.
Thank you. Just around the corner was another hidden gem. The turn of the 20th century saw the movement of European modernism in art as well as in architecture. At the center of it all was Spanish architect Antoni Gaudí, who was mostly known for his works in the Catalan region. But the Capricho de Gaudí, located in Comillas, showcases his earliest work as an innovator. We had the pleasure of meeting Carlos, the director of the Capricho de Gaudí, who took us deeper into this historical place.
And this house, one of the ingredients of the young Gaudí is like he's an exotic architect.
Yeah.
He's trying to bring exotism to his architecture. For example, this tower is inspired on a mosque, on a minaret. It's a mix between Africa and India and the exotism typical of the 19th century. So that's really important. And the second thing is nature. You look to the house, this is a sunflower.
So this is all made by hand?
Made by hand. Look to this part. this, if you use a stamp, you cannot produce this.
The one behind.
The one behind. So you need to use a mold that you separate in four pieces. It's a really complex process, and you need to paint it three times. Well, you have with the clay, yeah, brown, yeah, and you paint it three times. First is white, then it's green, and then it's yellow.
Yeah, and this one,
So it's a complex. For us today, when we have to restore those pieces, it's really complex. It's still like an artisan process. Let's move inside. Okay. I'll go show you the music thing and why the house is not finished.
Okay.
Okay.
Let's go. The decoration of this house is typical of the 19th century, a lot of white Italian marble, tropical wood, and a lot of tiles. And you still miss the music. This is the bathroom, of course, a bathroom today. Nice. Everyone today has a bathroom, but in the 19th century it was something reserved for the rich people. Yes. The favorite animal of Gaudi was bees.
Bees.
And you know why? Because bees are the perfect architects. They produce those hexagons. Yeah. It's the only perfect geometrical shape that exists in nature. Here, there's one thing that is unique to this house. You won't see these in any other Gaudi houses. Inside, there is a system with poles and counterweights. Again, you see? Four counterweights here, four. Here, there are a total of 20 counterweights. All the windows of the main floor work the same way. But Gaudi said, okay, if the owner of this house is a musician, I'm not going to use normal counterweights, I'm going to use bells. So I produce a musical box. You remember outside?
Yeah.
The musical lines. And I told you, this house is like a musical box. And now you see the music. So the whole house, it's all about nature, but at the same time, it represents the owner, music. 50-50, music and nature. This is Quijano, the owner, entered here to live the 30th of June, 1885. He passed away the 7th of July.
Why?
1 week?
He only lived here for 1 week. The reason why this house is not finished is because the owner died in 7 days. It's so sad, but it's part of our history. You know, people a lot of times tell me, Carlos, this is so sad. Don't worry, if you have a bad day, if you go to the east and wait enough, you know what happens every day on the east?
The sun will always rise.
Yeah. Yeah. And your life begins again from east to the west, turning. But this house, sad story, but today we are full of visitors. We enjoy telling the people the meaning of the house. From here, this is the origin, 30 years old, you can continue your trip, go to Barcelona, go to León, and understand the rest of the houses of Gaudi. So for me, it's enough for today. Yeah. I'm going to keep some secrets for the next time.
For us to come back.
After that lovely trip, Margarita and I got ourselves ready for a treat. In another small town called Ruy Loba lies the Bodega Miradorio. With an 8-hectare vineyard by the Cantabrian Sea, the Vino Blancos produced there are quite unique and aromatic. The Tuscio and the Mar de Fondo are just two of the seasonal wines made here, as our friend Sara will explain.
Sara, thank you so much for bringing us up to the vineyards.
Thank you for being here. It's a spectacular view, Sara. Yeah. Well, here in Cantabria, this is a special place because traditionally we didn't grow wines, okay? Or vineyards. Because at the end of the 19th century, disease came to Europe, which was a phylloxera. Mm-hmm. And it destroyed around 90% of the vineyards here in Europe. So in other places, they tried to recover the vineyards and continue producing wine, but here they decided to use these fields for other reasons.
Like
planting other crops or for animal grazing.
Yeah. That's it, for cattle in general. Yeah. Okay. So this is what happened here in Cantabria, and this is the moment where we lost the wine tradition, which is so popular in the rest of Spain, right? Mm-hmm. But now, in the last 20 years, many wineries here in Cantabria are trying to recover these and to plant new ones. Okay. And we are an example of these wineries here in Cantabria. Yeah. The sea is a key factor here for our wineries and for our plants, because when northern winds come, they take all the salt and they put it into the grape. Sometimes we even see the grape with this, with like they are white when they should be green.
Yeah. So it's like a crust that formed around.
That's it. From the, it's
from
a salt crust.
Yeah. Salt crust. Yeah.
And what kind of white wines do you have here?
Our white wines are special, I think, because they are quite high in acidity. So they are very fresh, very easy to drink. You should try them to, to find out.
I'm dying too. Okay. So what are we going to try now?
We're going to try two of our white wines, okay? Shall we start with
the first one? Yeah, let's start with the first
one. Excellent, good.
This one?
Yeah, that's one. This one has got 75% of Ondarrabi Zuri, which is the grape variety of the Chacolí wine.
Okay.
And 25% of Albariño, which is a Galician wine. Okay?
Yeah.
So let us try. As you can see, the color of the wine is very pale, almost transparent, and the smell is very citric.
Yes, you can.
Almost like a lemonade.
Yeah,
so,
right.
So fresh as a lemonade. Yeah.
Oh, so nice.
Wow.
It is nice.
Very refreshing.
Our mouth is watering because it's fresh.
Yes.
It's very easy to drink. And it's lovely for a sunny day.
Yes,
right?
Perfect.
And it's crisp.
Yeah.
And it's, that's it. Yeah. Very crispy. It is, indeed.
Very good.
So this is the first wine.
Mm-hmm.
And now the second wine, we call it Mar de Fondo because of the lovely views we've got. It means sea on the horizon, more or less. Because of the lovely views we have from the vineyards.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Okay. And in this wine, we decided to mix 25% of Codello, Ondarrabi Zuri, Albariño, and the Riesling grape we have. Okay?
Okay.
So all of those vines that we saw earlier today.
Yes.
That's it, yeah.
Right.
This wine shows the character of our winery.
Different.
Very different.
Completely different.
Yeah.
Ooh.
It's not so citric
anymore.
No. It's a little bit more with body, no?
Yeah.
This one?
With body, and that's because of the Godello grape.
Okay.
The Godello grape is high in fat, so it we see it has a complete different body.
Yeah.
That's it. The color is pretty golden.
Yes, more than the other one, yeah.
And the aromas we find here, they are peachy. They are pretty peachy.
Mmm.
Yes.
And that's a different experience.
Yeah.
It's wonderful to see the environment first and then to taste the wines and then the whole experience.
Yeah, the personality of Terroir is there.
It's there.
Yeah, absolutely. Gracias, Sara.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you.
This is the Museo de Altamira. Its permanent exhibit showcases a replica of the famous Altamira cave and the Paleolithic cave art that resides in it. The actual cave has been deemed a UNESCO World Heritage Site. The caves are inscribed by masterpieces of creative genius and humanity's earliest accomplished works of art. Margarita and I decided to pay a visit to see what the museum was all about. Pilar, thank you so much for having us here in the Museum of Altamira.
Well, you are very welcome. Mm-hmm. Welcome to this museum, the Museum of Altamira, which is the institution that manages the Cave of Altamira.
Okay.
The Cave of Altamira is one of the magnificent Paleolithic rock art caves in Europe. And it has one thing which make it special, that it was the first cave in which the Paleolithic rock art was defined.
Okay.
It was in 1879 when Marcelino Sanchez Autuola discovered this cave, and he explained very well that these paintings were made in the same time that the cave was inhabited by people, people like us, during Paleolithic times when we were hunter-gatherers, when we lived from what we hunted, what we feast, and the vegetables and the fruits that that we gathered.
Okay.
So in 1979, this institution was created in order to manage the research, the conservation, but also the outreach and the diffusion of the Cave of Altamira.
Yeah.
And now I invite you to know the art and the space where these people live here through the facsimile, the replica of the Cave of Altamira that we call the New Cave. We are under this polychrome ceiling, which is the most important and the most famous thing, let's say, from the Cave of Altamira. Here we have more than 24,000 years of art. There's no museum with such a big chronology in the work of art.
What would they use to color?
We have two pigments that they use in order to make the art. We are going to see the black ones, which is made with charcoal, and then we have the red color, which is made from iron oxides, is what we call ochre. And they just do it as powder, and then mix with water, they just put it in the rock. So the Yes, the Paleolithic rock art has these two main colors, black and red. If we talk about the themes in Paleolithic rock art, we can see it all of them here also in this polychrome ceiling. The first one, the most important, are animals.
Yes.
They are made in a very naturalistic way. Here you can see these incredible bisons. This is laying down. We may say that in Altamira the most important animal for them in this period it was the bison.
The bison.
Right? Yeah. Because the main animal that is represented is the bison. We can see also some horses.
Yes.
We can see the deer. We have also what we call signs. They are like abstraction. We can't say what they are representing, but they are forms that are repeated all over the cave, but not only in this cave, but in many other caves in the Cantabrian region, and also even in France.
Yes.
And the other thing that is represented in Paleolithic are the human representation. We only have some engravings that we call anthropomorphs, which mix human forms and animal forms. And here we can see these hands, right? They just put the hand on the rock and then paint it all around.
They paint around the hand?
Yes.
Thank you so much for taking us through the reproduction of the caves of Altamira.
Thanks to you. I hope you enjoy knowing the art of Altamira.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Gracias, Pilar.
Gracias.
G just a stone's throw away from the museum is the center of Santillana del Mar, a quaint town that shows a side of old Spain that we usually see in books or in old movies. Tourism here thrives, with a few paradores all around the traditional setting of the town. The whole town is a registered national monument due to the large numbers of preserved and intact medieval buildings. Cantabria is a region full of interesting discoveries and natural magnificence. While it may not be as famous as other Spanish regions, it was a rewarding destination. As they say, Cantabria is short in distance, but endless in experiences. This is Raul Manzano, EIC, on the move.